Καλησπέρα σας, καλοί φίλοι τηλεθεατές. Καλωσορίσατε στο πρόγραμμά μας, στην εκπομπή μας Faces, πρόσωπα. I have to turn to English straight away because I have to deal with a couple of people who are able to speak. One of them might be able to speak Greek, but the other one, I don't think he can
speak. I only understand the odd word.
You can only understand, yes.
Yeah, the odd word here and there.
Yeah, it's actually it's Angelo from Cyprus, yes?
That's right.
Born in Cyprus, Angelo. And Martin, you are from
Correct.
England, yes.
Yes.
And you both are in a group, you know, in
yep.
a band,
yep.
which actually the band started a long time ago, 1960, whatever.
1964. The band actually started before that. We got together as the Sheratons, mm-hmm. I formed them, handpicked the musicians, and got together in my house, in my bedroom, my parents' house, and we became the Sheratons. Okay.
Were you a musician as well? Or?
We were all musicians,
musicians
at the time. It does get a little bit complicated because Honey, who was the female drummer,
uh-huh.
and that was unheard of back in 1960. 263, we weren't famous yet,
mm-hmm.
and she was my fiance
okay.
at that time. And what actually happened was she and her brother used to follow this band, Sheratons,
mm-hmm.
around London, doing
all right.
gigs all
yes.
around London. And John, who her brother, John Lantry, is Honey Lantry and John Lantry, and John said to me, one day, he said, I want to play bass. I said, John, you can't play bass. He said, I want you to teach me bass. I said, I'm not a bass player, I'm a guitarist. So I said, but you can teach me some runs, they're called runs or walks,
uh-huh.
on the four top strings of the bass, of the guitar. So I said, I could do that. He was actually following us around playing congos and bongos, but he did this from time to time. He didn't do it on a regular basis. So I said to him, John, look, at the end of the day, you know, a bass guitar to match the models that we've got is going to cost you about 350-380 quid.
That time?
At that time.
Uh-huh.
They were all handmade,
yes,
these
yeah,
guitars.
Handmade, yeah.
yeah, all handmade. Yeah. And I said, so at the end of the day, there's not just that. I said, but there's the time you've got to spend with me is going to be about 3 months before we can go and get gigs with you. Of which his reply was, well, can't we give it a try?
Mm-hmm.
So I said, well, if you're prepared to pay the money and get the bass, I can get the bass through Jim Burns. He was the guy who built the Burns guitars, the famous British Burns guitars. And he said, the money's not a problem. His dad was in big business, neon signs, neon sign companies, that kind of thing. He built neon signs all over, mm-hmm. for all over England. So he said, that's not a problem. I can get the money now if you want. So I said, well, let's find out if we can get the bass first. And that's what happened. I found we could get the bass. Went and John gave me the money, went and picked up the bass. And from that moment on, he switched from the congos and bongos
mm-hmm.
to learning the bass with me. 3 months later, he had more or less mastered the bass. I could only teach him so much, but
yes.
he was so good at it,
yeah,
it was
yeah.
a natural.
Yeah, he was a talent.
Yeah.
Well. So you formed a group and you start doing gigs or you record songs?
Yeah.
What's happened? How you started?
We actually started by doing... after we'd rehearsed the band and got it tight,
mm-hmm.
we started doing weddings, parties,
mm-hmm.
bar mitzvahs, that kind of thing. Parties, things like that. And we managed to get some gigs in pubs.
Okay.
One of those was the Malmö Tavern in Bulls Pond Road. And we got a residency there
mm-hmm.
for 3 days of the week.
Oh, that's good.
So that was good. And it was reasonably well paid.
Yes. And then you start thinking about writing songs and all this kind of thing.
I'd already been writing. I've been writing since I was like 10, 12 years old.
Okay. Before we go to Angelo, do we have anything to show from that time? Do we have any a video clip to show the beginning of your recordings?
Not in the format they were done then. Uh-huh. The format they've been changed into now, yes, we do have.
We re-recorded them. You re-recorded them. Yes. Okay, it doesn't matter. As long as it's an original song, which you did it again, yes? Okay, let's go and listen to something, you know. And do you have in mind what you're going to see? Can you give us information?
Well, it would be the song Have I the Right, which was the first song that they recorded, which became a multi-million selling record. Mm-hmm. About 30 countries in the world, it was number one.
Of the world was number one.
My God, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah, the rest of the world was in the top.
Up to the top five. Top five, the rest of the world.
Let's go and see that video clip and then we'll come back and carry on.
Okay,
sure. Okay. From 1964, Have I the Right?
1964, my God, yes.
Yeah.
Let's go and see it.
To hold you, you know I've always told you that we must never, ever part. Oh, have I the right to kiss you? You know I'll always miss you. I've loved you from the very start. How much you send those shivers running down my spine? Ooh, have I the right to thrill you? You know I'm waiting till you give me the right to make you mine. Well, come right back. I just can't bear it. I run to love and I long to share it. Come right back. I'll show my
Have I the right? Έχω το δικαίωμα in Greek, yes?
That's correct.
Okay, that's fine. That's a nice song, yes. So, after that, you changed the name?
No, what actually happened was Joe Meek, our record producer, who we got assigned to, was an independent record producer. Uh-huh. And he was a massive world hit record producer. And what happened was he was licensing the record to Pi Records.
Okay.
And Pi, when they were looking at the managing director, when he was looking at the photos of us, he said, they look such a sweet group. We've got to give them a sweet name. So they came up with a name. He suddenly said, the Honeycombs. Honeycombs is sweet. and they look sweet enough to me to be The Honeycombs. So all of a sudden we have a new name, The Honeycombs, coming from the managing director of Pi Records.
Okay. And you record many, many songs with
them? Quite a good few hundred, yeah. Mm. Yeah, we did.
So when Angelo came in, when did you join them, Angelo? And give us a relationship. I mean, how
well,
it started?
I've known Martin for about 40 years now. And we were writing songs at the time as well. But when this latest project came up for the album to be made, I was only interested in writing songs, nothing else. Mm-hmm. Then one of the songs came up, the title is, what's the title of the song? No.
Mary Jo.
No.
I can't remember.
Without You's Night.
Oh, yes.
And
yes,
they decided that I would be able to sing this song fairly well.
Were you singing before in a different group? Or?
Not in different groups. I've made records before. Mm-hmm. I've worked with a girl from Bonnie M, Maisie Williams, a girl from who was starring in Miss Saigon. I made a record with her as well. So basically, it wasn't a full-time profession.
You were writing for others.
Yeah, I was writing, and that's about it. So basically, they thought that I could do a good job on that song, and that's how it came about.
You sang the song?
Yeah.
Okay, it's just one song you're singing on this
Just
album.
One song, and I'm singing backing vocals on a couple of other,
well.
on
other tracks.
Yes, yes. Well, I think it's a good idea to listen to that song.
Thank you.
Listen to you, Angelo, singing it, okay?
Mm.
Let's go and listen to Angelo's singing.
Without you, without you.
Okay, Angelo, it's nice, nice song. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And just a little bit more about you, because you know, reading your short biography, you were here, and then you returned to Cyprus. When did you go back to Cyprus? And you stay for a couple of years, and then you have to come back again.
Give us a story. I came here in 1965. Mm-hmm. Originally, so I could go back and join my father as a meteorologist. I was working for the British at the time. Well, at the same time, while I was studying, I got involved in music and I got involved in modeling as well. Mm-hmm. And that's how I met Martin with music. 1973, I went back to Cyprus and I had an interview so I could get a job.
Just before the invasion.
I was accepted and I was going to start September 1974.
What kind of job was that?
A meteorologist.
Okay, so you get the job.
It was with the British,
but
yes.
But you were going to start after summer.
I was going to come back and get some other certificates that I needed and then
go back. Did you came back before the invasion, before the war?
Yes, well, I came back in 1973 again because I had to come back in 73 and then...
So instead of going back to Cyprus to start work, you stay in England?
That's right, yes.
And what's happened then? I mean...
Well, at the time I was still sort of involved in music a little bit. Then I became an estate agent at the London Accommodation Agency.
You went where the money is. I mean, it was and is still.
Yes, well, yes, yes. with your friend John Kyriakidis, and then John moved to Bayswater, and I stayed in Blackstock Road.
You still dealing with properties?
Not anymore. No, I'm not dealing with properties at the moment. At the same time, I was playing football as well. I was
professional.
Well, not professionally, no. But I was involved with the Greek teams. I started basically in 1966. I went for a trial with Arsenal. Oh. And I was there for about 6 months.
Okay.
And that's about it. But then my interest is still music.
You still write
and sport.
Yes,
I'm still writing, mm-hmm. and sport and football and tennis. So, mm-hmm. and all basically retired at this age.
Yes,
now,
yes. So. You make your money and you don't have to.
Well.
Yeah. From properties, I suppose. Yes, and all this. So
well,
what's happening
so
with music now at the moment? I mean, you have this song, you sang this, and you the album is out and all this.
That's right.
What's happening? Are you planning to, you know, do gigs and all this kind of thing? Or
eventually, yes, but unfortunately, as I said, the guitarist died.
Ah.
Well, top guitarist, he died. As soon as we kind of finished the album, and we can't go out on the road until we get a band together.
We've got to get a replacement.
But at the moment, we've been doing a lot of interviews with a lot of radio stations, magazines. The album's been selling well, slowly but well, all over the world. Not just, I mean, we had interest from Scandinavia to Jakarta and Indonesia, for instance. Uh-huh. So it's been doing well.
Okay, I like to just, watch another DVD,
video?
Which is from these songs again.
Yeah.
And then we talk a little bit more about future plans on this kind of
you
thing.
You can use Love in Tokyo.
Love in Tokyo.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go and watch Love in Tokyo.
Love in Tokyo, it won't
Lovely. Very nice. So back to what you say about, you know, I mean, you have radio play and all this kind of thing. How is it going? I mean, which stations
that's a good question.
Interested to play the song?
How much time do we have?
Yeah. Thank God, we're getting a lot of airplay. Getting a lot of airplay over the whole of the country that we know, because they're phoning me to talk to me and ask me questions. Can we come and do an interview?
They want an interview.
They want an interview, or right. Whether it be on the telephone, or whether
you
it be go
visit
there.
Them
yeah, or go there and do a live show. We've done Cambridge and six or seven BBC shows now.
And that's because of the fame you had there.
That's right. All because this is a revisit.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a revisit back to the Holloway Road days, and it's virtually all the hit songs been rehashed in a completely modern way.
Are the musicians, I mean, most of them, they are new, yes?
It's a new band. It's a new band.
Yes. So you get, you know, good radio play. And
we're having, all over the world, we're getting terrific response from stations that we can't make, and it's getting played sublimely by them.
How about television? I mean, do they ask?
That's much more difficult. We've made a conscious effort. We said from this week onwards, we would make a conscious effort now to concentrate on the TV stations now with, you know, promo, with all the promo, all the popular shows, chat shows, etc., breakfast TV, your TV, etc.
Shall we, play another video clip? Which one you want to play before we go to the final, you know, just talk about future plans?
Crazy But I Can't Stop.
Crazy But I Can't Stop.
Yeah.
Είμαι τρελός, αλλά δεν μπορώ να σταματήσω.
Crazy
But I Can't Stop.
Actually, sorry to interrupt you. Actually, I just read in one of the write-ups about the album and myself that Martin Murray with Crazy But I Can't Stop is more or less, rather than being a song, it's a statement. He's, in other words, what they're saying, he's crazy,
it's about
but he
you.
Can't.
It's about
if they're
you.
Saying he's crazy and he
you
can't
wrote,
stop.
You wrote it, yes?
I didn't write that actually. But at the end of the day, I know what the guy's saying. Because being the age that I am.
At such a young age, you know.
That's a joke. Being the age that I am, they're saying it, but they're saying it's a good thing because they're enjoying what they're hearing. The bulk of the public out there who are doing the Google write-ups, who are doing the YouTube write-ups, who are doing the Facebook write-ups, and our own site as well.
Yes.
www.honeycombs.co.uk.
This is your website, yes.
Yeah.
Are your songs all there on our website, yes?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, they're on Amazon, they're on iTunes, and you name it, it's on it.
Everything. Let's go and watch I Am Crazy But I Can't Stop. Είμαι τρελός, αλλά δεν μπορώ να σταματήσω. Somebody like you. Yeah. Είμαι τρελός, αλλά δεν μπορώ να σταματήσω. I am crazy, but I can't stop.
Correct.
Anyway, is the CD going well? You know, what's happening?
The album, time I phoned, Peter Pennell is the managing director of Angel Air Records. And this is the label we're on. And a few days ago, I phoned him, and I had some important questions for him. And one of the questions was, how are we doing worldwide? Uh-huh. He said, we're not setting the world alight at the moment, but we are selling very well, we're selling steadily.
Steady.
Okay.
Okay, so that's good news.
Lovely. So, how can anyone get the album? I mean, get it from Amazon?
Yes.
From your website?
Yes, our website.
Not our website, no.
But no, Amazon. You can get it from his website, from Angel Air Records, but in general it's Amazon.
iTunes.
Deezer, mm-hmm. iTunes. You name it, uh-huh. Anything that's on the website, you can purchase. You can purchase from EMI, HMV,
yes.
Beg your pardon, HMV, and any record shops you might be able to find in the UK, which yes. are very few and far between, and they will order it in for you.
Yes. What was the cost of producing the CD? I mean, nowadays, is great, it the same
question.
As...
That is a terrific question.
Yes. What was, is it big difference than...
To what it was? I don't know what it cost, the original one back in 64 that was made, but this one...
This one, the cost would have been about £50,000,
to put it. 50,000?
Yeah, yes. Easy.
And it took a year and 2 months, possibly a year and 3 months.
Yeah. It went longer, didn't it?
Yeah, slightly longer,
because it was technically... It was
how much time...
I'm just coming to that. Technically, it was supposed to take about 3 to 4 months mm-hmm. to do, because it was the 50th anniversary mm-hmm. of the Honeycombs
of the band.
The massive hit.
Yes.
Have I the Right?
Mm-hmm.
And because of technicalities going wrong, because of group members getting the flu, unwell, there was hold-ups.
Okay.
So that was happening to us. So we didn't make the 50th anniversary date. But the people who are so kind to us and writing the write-ups are saying things like, it doesn't matter, Martin, it was well worth the wait. They're so thrilled yeah. with what they're buying and hearing mm-hmm. or receiving as promotional goods. They're so thrilled with it that they're all saying, I haven't had a bad word from any of them, it was well worth the wait. It doesn't matter you missed the 50th anniversary.
Yes. So, talking about the musicians now, you use those musicians and you formed a band.
Yes, now the band was formed
the
prior.
The band is ready yes. if you want to take some gigs and all this kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Yes,
yes. yes. So other than, sorry to interrupt you, other than the fact we mentioned this earlier, that unfortunately Mick had died,
the lead guitarist,
and we are now
and you're looking
in
for
the throes.
A new guitarist.
Yeah, but he's got to be... and this is very difficult, he's got to be of the caliber or as close as we can get to Mick, because Mick was phenomenal.
It has to be very good, and it has to be age, it doesn't matter.
Age is not relevant, not really relevant.
As long as he's not 18 or 19.
No. Well, yeah, that won't be the case. But at the end of the day, they have to be in his calibre. They've got to be a very good, that type of guitar work has got to come to the forefront. And that's what we're looking for at the moment.
Do you advertise that? I mean, you're looking for one, or you
What you do is you go internally, first of all.
Yeah, you look through your contacts.
Go through all your contacts, first of all, within the industry.
I know.
Unfortunately, at the moment, the majority are well set.
Yes, in they're working and they're
working, they're earning their money, etc., etc. So that's being a little bit difficult. It's looking like we might have to go to Musicians Union. And there are other places you can go. You can advertise and do an audition thing.
Yeah, I know.
So
yeah, it might be a good idea to do an audition.
Well, and you can do a day's audition.
We can film it and, you know, make a new show. Auditioning.
That would be a nice idea.
Yes, you know, it's a good idea. What do you think?
That would be a nice
idea. Think about it.
Yeah.
Can I just cut in and say,
please,
one of the best compliments we had as well, when this album was being sold in Japan, actually, on the same page next to our album, it was Adele's album 25.
Oh my God.
So
yes.
I think that was, he said something about it, which means that, you know, people, they rated it very highly to put it next to.
Okay, I am looking forward to see if you can manage to, you know, put up auditions and if we can film the auditions, and then looking forward to see the first gig of the band.
Oh, that would be terrific. Yes. We can get that together.
We'll discuss it with the rest of the guys as well. And
we'll discuss that. And I can't see there being a problem at all.
Good idea.
The only fabulous idea.
Yeah, yeah.
The only problem at this very moment as we speak is what's just been mentioned. We have to find that right guy.
Yes.
Or gal.
Yes.
Or gal. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. As long as it's good.
Long as they're a good musician.
It's a very good idea to audition, you know, to have people coming in and audition for
You have your open day.
So you choose the best one. You know.
Yes, you have your open day where you advertise just for that. Lead guitarist wanted for named 60s band, blah, blah, blah.
Exactly, yes.
That kind of thing. And you have this open day from 10 in the morning at a certain place, 10 in the morning till 8 at night, and you run through the people that turn up.
So the Hellenic X Factor.
Yeah. Very good.
Hellenic X Factor, yes. Well, with this, I have to say a big thank you to you.
Thank you to you.
Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you for coming in, and I'm sure, you know, you can find the right guy or right girl for the place.
I'm sure,
you know,
we will.
And
I don't have
any doubts. As I say, I'm looking forward to you know,
bless you,
come to the first gig.
Thank you so much.
You know, wish you all the best.
Thank you very
much. Once again, thank you for having us.
Yes,
okay,
we're going to
close with an instrumental. Would you mind telling us about this a little bit about this instrumental?
The instrumental is a melody that goes back to 1962-63. And it was a Joe Meek composed thing called Totem Pole, but it did have a subtitle, and the subtitle was Howard's Way. And that was a theme for a TV series called Howard's Way in 1961-ish.
So it's a famous...
it's a very famous tune.
That's good. Lovely.
Very famous tune.
TV
show in 1960s, yes?
I think the actual theme of the show was all about a shipping yard.
That's right. Somewhere in... I think it was... Yeah.
But it was an orchestral version that was chosen above our instrumental version.
Yes.
That can be heard on YouTube.
Lovely.
But as I said... because it's such a good instrumental, we wanted to do it again in a new modern.
You haven't got it on the album.
It's on the album.
It's on the album.
Yeah.
Lovely, beautiful. Okay, then. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And we're going to listen to this instrumental.
Okay.
And we close with that.
Thank you.
I have to say a big thank you to our audience, and I wish you have a good week. you and me, we're going to get together again next Sunday at the same time with a new face or faces. Till then, look after yourselves. Good night.